Random House Audiobooks presents Ava's Man. This is the author, Rick Bragg. She was old all my life, even when I was sitting in the red dirt, fascinated with my own toes. Ava's face had a line in it for every hot mile she ever walked, for every fit she ever threw. Her hair was long and black as crows, streaked with white, and her eyes, behind the ancient yellow glass of her round spectacles, were pale, pale blue, almost silver. The blind have eyes like that color, but Ava could see fine. Ava could see forever. She could tell your fortune by gazing into the dregs of your coffee cup, and swore that if the bottoms of your feet itched, you would walk on strange ground. She could be gentle as a baby bird and sweet as divinity candy, but if her prescription was off or she just got mad, she'd sit bolt upright in bed at 3 o'clock in the morning and dog cuss anyone who came to mind, including the dead. Some days she would doze in her rocker and speak softly to people that I could not find, even by looking under the porch. Now I know I was just listening to her dreams. In her time, she buried 2 daughters, one just a baby, one full grown. And when she passed 80, my aunts just stopped telling her when people she loved had died. A kindness, I suppose. Near the end of her life, as her mind began to wobble, she would recall how pretty my ex-wife looked at Christmas dinner 18 years ago, yet not remember yesterday. But when I think of her now, I think of a woman still strong and hard in her late 60s, a woman with a banjo propped against the foot of her bed, 10,000 hairpins in the pocket of her dress, and more personalities than the state hospital in Tuscaloosa. I think about how the sudden summer thunderstorms would rattle the window glass and make cups jump off their saucers, and how, unimpressed, the old woman would just take a dip of snuff and mumble, "Old devil's beating his wife." Because she was old and could be trusted with babies and half-wits, it was her job to watch over me when my mama, her 6th child, went to work. She would look down on me from her rocker, talking to me and, as she grew older, herself. In time, I could even gauge that old woman's mood by the pace of her chair squeaking runners on the bare pine planks. Slow when her mind was restful, quick when she was mad, and fast, racehorse fast, when she was remembering. She had been widowed young and never remarried, and as a child I just assumed she'd always been that way, an old woman alone. There was a man once, a peddler for the Saxon Candy Company, who seemed to have a lot more on his mind than saltwater taffy. But if that little old man was a suitor, he was pitiful at it, and he did not give up so much as just timidly fade away. That did not stop her grandchildren from kidding her about him, from asking if she was going to run off with him some day in his panel truck full of pecan logs. "Grandma," we would ask in a joke that spanned 20 years, "you going to get you a man?" Most times she just sniffed and ignored us. But sometimes she would slap her heavy black shoes down hard on the porch applying the brakes, and the rocker's runners would freeze in mid-squeak. We fled, usually, because she was prone to strike out, quick as a rattler, and knock us upside the head when she was displeased. But instead of hollering or swinging at us, she'd just start to grin, as if something that had gone cold in her memory had begun to glow for just a second or two in time. It was probably just her medicine again. But it is better to believe it was a speck of heat from something that had once crackled and roared along the banks of the Coosa River back when it was wild, in the days before the power company dams turned it into a big brown faucet that could be switched on and off at will. "No, hun," she would say, "I ain't going to get me no man." And then she would start to rock again with satisfaction. "I had me one." His name was Charlie Bundrum, and he was probably the only man on earth who could love that woman and not perish in the flame. He was a tall, bone-thin man who worked with nails in his teeth and a roofing hatchet in a fist as hard as a gust of brick, who ran a trot line across the Coosa baited with chicken guts and caught washtubs full of catfish, who cooked good white whiskey in the pines, drank his own product, and sang, laughed, and buck-danced under stars. He was a man whose tender heart was stitched together with steel wire, who stood beaten and numb over a baby's grave in Georgia, then took a simple-minded man into his home to protect him from scoundrels who liked to beat him for fun. He was a man who inspired backwood legends and the kind of loyalty that still makes old men dip their heads respectfully when they say his name. but who is bad to drink too much, misses turn into the driveway and run over his own mailbox. He was a man who did the things more civilized men dreamed they could, who beat one man half to death for throwing a live snake at his son, who shot a large woman with a 410 shotgun when she tried to cut him with a butcher knife, who beat the hell out of two worrisome Georgia highway patrolmen and threw them headfirst out the front door of a beer joint called the Maple on the Hill. He was a man who led deputies on long, hapless chases across high, lonesome ridges and through briar-choked bogs, whose hands were so quick he snatched squirrels from trees, who hunted without regard to seasons or quotas because how could a game warden in Montgomery or Atlanta know if his babies were hungry? He was just a man, I guess, whose wings never quite fit him right, who built dozens of pretty houses for Depression-era wages and never managed to build one for the people he loved the most, who could not read but always asked Ava to read him the newspaper so he would not be ignorant, who held iron bars and babies in his massive hands and called my mama Pooh Boy, which makes me smile. He died in the spring of 1958, 1 year before I was born. I have never forgiven him for that. For most of my life, he was no more real, no more complete than a paper doll. I learned, scrap by scrap, that he was a carpenter, roofer, whiskey maker, sawmill hand, well digger, hunter, poacher, and riverman. Born at the turn of the century in a part of the country that is either Alabama or Georgia, depending on how lost you are or if you even care. But I knew almost nothing else about him growing up, because no one in my mama's family talked much about him. As years and even decades slipped by, I began to wonder if I would uncover anything at all about my grandfather, or if he would just remain a man of secrets I would never know. It could not be, I knew, that his children were ashamed of him. The flashes of his life they had let slip from time to time were bright, quick, and warm, a sliver of light under a closed door. But in a family rich in storytellers, they were stingy with him, just him. It always left me with the same feeling I used to get when we would drive past the giant Merida bread factory in Birmingham. The smell of baking bread, mouth-watering, would fill the car for just a few seconds, then vanish as we sped on, leaving me daydreaming about sandwiches. I asked my mama 2 Christmases ago why I had heard so little about him from her and her sisters. She told me it was just a matter of time. Only in the past few years, as his oldest son passed 70, as his children marked the 42nd anniversary of their father's death, was there enough space between then and now to talk about him, to really remember. In the past, talking about his life always led to thinking about his death, to a feeling like running your fingers through sawbriars. And what good is that? After Daddy died, my mama told me, it was like there was nothing. I remember the night, an icy night in December. I asked 3 of Charlie Bundrum's daughters to tell me about his funeral. I sat in embarrassment as my aunts, all in their 60s, just stared hard at the floor. Juanita, tough as whalebone in hell, began to softly cry, and Joe, who has survived Uncle John and ulcers, wiped at her eyes. My mother, Margaret, got up and left the room. For coffee, she said. What kind of man was this, I wondered, who is so beloved, so missed, that the mere mention of his death would make them cry 42 years after he was preached into the sky? A man like that, I thought to myself, probably deserves a book. I had a grandfather, another, who really did get drunk, hitch his wagon, and drive through the mill village of my hometown shouting dirty limericks to church ladies and Jehovah Witnesses until the town sheriff hauled him away in chains. But my daddy's daddy, Bobby Bragg, though entertaining as hell, had never seemed to claim us. He was not cruel, merely indifferent. And between rants and incarcerations, he would do his best not to step on us very much as we played on his porch. So, since I never really had a grandfather, I decided to make me one. I asked my mother's people to tell me all the stories they could remember from Charlie Bundrum's life and times. With their help, I built him up from dirt level, using half-forgotten sayings, half-remembered stories, and a few yellowed, brittle, black-and-white photographs that, under the watch of my kin, I handled like diamonds. 2, in particular, tell his story. In one, he's dressed in his Sunday go-to-meeting clothes, not his overalls, but his big wrists and scarred, tar-stained, gnarled hands tell on.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.